Hello, Mr. Arniger, a retired lecturer in metallurgy, nothing to do with the theology, but I preach Christianity and Sikhism. And here is exposition of Hebrews 10, verse 19 to 39, the full assurance of faith. Therefore, brothers, since we have full confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way mean that you can think, you have to think logically. If you can't think logically, you are not new or living, you are dead. Not like the letters, you know, you read the letters, as it is written, you just obey it. It is not like that. This is a new covenant of living people, not of the dead in letters. By the new and living way that He opened for us through the curtain. That means holiest of holy was that now you can have direct approach to God. That is through His flesh. By giving His own sacrifice as Lamb of the God. And not that of the scapegoat which was given, and that did not open that curtain. That curtain remained closed. So by giving His own sacrifice, He opened the curtain of the holiest of holy. So that means He is our royal priest who is more effective than the temple priest. They used to give sacrifice every year, which did not suffice, we did not satisfy. And since we have a great anointed royal high priest over the house of God, this is the house of God, our physical body, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience. So sprinkled clean with the blood of Christ. You know, you have the body of Jesus and blood of Christ. Blood of Christ is His word, and His word cleans our conscience. Clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water through the baptism of John the Baptist. When John the Baptist baptized you, he then baptized you in pure water in the name of Abraham. Jesus was baptized in the name of Yahweh. This is nonsense, you know, in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is all nonsense. John the Baptist said, one who come after me will do it. Not he did it. We can also say that covenant of our physical bodies with Yahweh and His priest in Moses became useless. That our anointed royal high priest Jesus, royal high priest Christ Jesus has established a perfect covenant with our Father through His own sacrifice, and not those of the scapegoat animals as in the old covenant with the Yahweh. That covenant, old covenant, it could not wash the sin. Every year, you know, they have to do it again and again. And Jesus did it once for all to clean our hearts, to establish the new covenant, to open the inner covenant, our holiest of holy. The old covenant led to works and reincarnation, which is not perfect. Reincarnation means you are coming into death and birth cycle. You never end, you know. Whilst our new covenant is of faith, that matures in resurrection for eternal life, as demonstrated by Jesus in Lazarus. So, this is the, let us hold fast the covenant and not confession of our hope. You know, we have to hold covenant with, we have to work both ways. Confession doesn't mean that you just say, I'm sorry, you know, all that. No, this is confession. Covenant means you keep talking with each other. You are living with him and he is not separated from you. Confession was in Yahweh, who was alienated up somewhere in heaven. We don't know where he is. So our God is within us, Immanuel. And not confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful, unlike the hireling priest of Moses. The priests of Moses became hireling, you know, they were paid money. But our anointed royal priest was not hireling. So these dog-collared peoples who are hirelings of Mammon, they are worse than Moses priest. So they are antichrist. The present dog-collared hireling priest of Mammon are worse than those of Moses. And let us consider how to stir up one another to agape. You know, agape is the divine love and good works. Now, you know, agape is the sign of a twice born. A person is once born if he knows only that he was born from his parents, whether they are white, brown or black. So he knows only those parents. But when you know your real parent, our Father God, from which the soul emanated, when you realize that one, our soul is the real self, not this physical body. Somebody is born in Africa, some in England, some in India, different color soil, different color. So far you are just judging people on the basis of color. You are once born. As soon as you realize it's the inner self that count, not the color of the skin, then you are twice born, and then you have the love called agape, divine love. Eros is between the people of the same color, same tribe, family. So stir up one another, agape love and good works, not neglecting to meet together in fellowships of the royal priest. We meet together fellowships, and in us nobody is greater or lower. Wherever three or four are gathered together in the name of Jesus, Jesus is present among you, guiding you, you know, what is the truth. When you talk, then somebody says something, then you interact. When you interact, you know, then you talk, tell them, think logically, and you get the logos. As is the habit of in some synagogues. In synagogue, you know, they meet people. But encouraging one another through logical reasoning. But we encourage, in synagogue, you have a priest, Moses priest, who guide you. What apply to flesh, the opposite to spirit. In the Church of God, we have fellowship of the royal priest. The word of God, logical reasoning, guide us. That is our royal priest, logical reasoning. So logical, anybody speak logical reasoning, he is a royal priest. So what we call in Punjabi Shabd, or his word, you know, is our guide. And all the more as you see the day drawing near, all the more as you see the day drawing near. Day here mean the Christ, age of Christ. This dark age was brightened to day, to daylight for us by Christ Jesus, to see for ourselves through logical reasoning what we should do to be resurrected. So we have to, you know, do think ourselves, you know, what we should do to get logo and be talking to our Father. That is the only language our Father understand, logos, not prayer. Prayer was in Yahweh, you know. Our Father is not deaf. He is living inside us. And everyone is to give his own account to God. So nobody, these dog-collared people can't give your account to God. So they are antichrist and they know it, they are antichrist. But they still carry on because the people are spiritually blind, stones. They are turning stones into bread. No more rabbis are these dog-collared hirelings to misguide us. For if we go on blaspheming and not sinning, you know, in sinning is not in Jesus, nothing to do with sin. It is corruption, you know. As in Holy Spirit, transgression against the Holy Spirit is blaspheming and not sin. There is a more serious blasphemy than sin. So this is more serious because sin is spoken on individual level. One person speak, does the sin, you know, and he get punished by the rabbi. But blasphemy is spoken on communal basis. You can't punish anyone. The result, the blasphemy is not punished by men, but by God Himself, Holy Spirit. Jesus said, you know, if you blaspheme against me, or say something against me, or against God, is forgiven. But blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is not forgivable. So this is what it means, you know, that when you say blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, what you think is right, but you say wrong from your mouth, as at the trial of Jesus, they shouted, kill him. They blaspheme, and they all suffer. Is more serious blasphemy than sin. Deliberately, after receiving the knowledge of gospel truth, when you know the gospel truth and you speak, blasphemy is very, very serious. There no longer remains a sacrifice for sins committed on individual basis, but a fearful expectation of judgment, as the Jews suffered at the destruction of temple forever and the holocaust overseas for blaspheming, in which you cannot blame a third person than you yourself who rejected the gospel truth, and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. There are no adversary in Jesus. In everyone is the light of God. So we can't hate somebody. If we hate a person, we are hating the one whose light is inside the person. So in Jesus, we don't hate anyone. Whatever you do, you reap the reward of it. If you do good thing to others, you receive good fruit. If you do evil, you receive evil. So that's your own business. So we can't blame somebody. So people do it and they will suffer at the end. Those who do good works, they get resurrected. And those who do bad works, evil, they are thrown back into the world to be born again and death cycle. So here it is, who rejected the gospel truth, and those who know the gospel truth, and then they reject it, you know, That is very, very serious. That is blasphemy. That is not forgivable. Some of these dog-collared priests, they know what they are doing is wrong. But they keep on doing, you know, because for the sake of, you know, their family, because the other people are doing and nobody is pointing finger at them. So they keep on doing, you know, that nobody knows. Let us keep on stealing. Like Judas Iscariot was stealing money from the purse. So these dog-collared people steal money from the church purse. At the end of the month, they put their hand in to take money out as salary. So they are thieves, you know, in Judas Iscariot type. There are no, adversaries. Consume the adversary, that was the Jewish, you know, that under Yahweh is that applies. There are no adversary as everyone reaps the reward of his own conscience. Holy one, good, evil one, evil, bad. Anyone who has set aside or transgresses against the law of Moses dies without mercy on the evidence of two or three witnesses, as the temple high priest tried to get against Jesus to accuse him to death. Now this is, you know, sin, you know. You need only two or three people to attest that this man said so and so or did so and so, transgression against the moral laws. But in the case of Jesus, you know, let's see what it happens. Two or three and accused to death. Going against the laws of Moses is a sin committed on individual basis and punished on individual basis. Whilst the Jews blasphemy against Jesus at his trial, suffered punishment on communal basis. So that blasphemy spoken at when Jesus was at trial, you know, Pilate knew in his heart that what they are saying is wrong, you know, that he is a good man. And people, some small amount of people came to Pilate telling him, look, he did a good job to me. He's a good man. But the majority was shouting, kill him, kill him. So that majority was of the evil people, blasphemers. So blasphemers were in majority, and because these politicians as you have today, if the majority asks something, they do it for the sake of votes. Popularity, same, you know, Pilate also wanted popularity. So when the majority said, kill him, he said there's nothing wrong with him. He doesn't deserve death, you know, that's why he washed his hand under sun, that I have nothing to do with the blood of this innocent man. And he put that symbol, king of the Jews, as they wanted to exploit Pilate, incite him, you know, hey, this one want to be king, we want you to be the king, not him. To praise the Pilate and despise the Jesus by calling him a king. He was a royal king. How much worse punishment do you think? So that was spoken on communal basis, you know, the blasphemy. How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has spurned the Son of God, who killed him, you know, and has profaned the blood of the covenant of righteousness? Because that covenant of righteousness comes from your heart. In their heart, they knew he's a good man, but they broke that covenant, became unrighteous sons of Satan, by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Holy Spirit or has become hypocrite. So the righteousness is the covenant by which we are sanctified. And when they broke that covenant, you know, of righteousness, and became unrighteous. There are plenty in the world, you will see them, you know, they go to church and everything, but they do unrighteous thing. So they are like this one, you know, devils, sons of Satan, and has outraged the Holy Spirit. That means transgression against the Holy Spirit is blasphemy, or have become hypocrites. That is why the temple priests were called the brood of vipers by John the Baptist for hypocrisy. So all these people, you know, like Ian Paisley in Northern Ireland, on communal basis they go and demonstrate, and on communal basis the Catholic also come out and they fight with each other. One fold, one shepherd. They forget about that, and that is what happened when the blind guide lead the blind, they fall into the pit. For we know him, the demiurge God Yahweh, who said, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," or tit-for-tat. You know, this "vengeance is mine" is Old Testament saying, not new one. New one, you know, the God, you know, he deals with it. We leave it to him. This is of Yahweh, demiurge, God of nature, where tit-for-tat applies. And again, the Lord Yahweh will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God, as blasphemy kills many. That was the dead God, demiurge, Yahweh, our living Father God, to fall into his hand, you know, do wrong thing, you know, blasphemy kills many. But recall the former days. Recall the former days when, after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings. That means when people were enlightened with this new covenant, people were not ready to accept it. And when they were in Jerusalem, they were frightened to come out of the house because of the Jews wanted to kill them or hurt them. But Jesus told them, not a single hair can come out of your head without the will of our Father. So you stay among them with courage. That is why Jesus told them to stay in Jerusalem, to harden them. Sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, that means people will, you know, hate you, they will kill you, they will affliction, you know, they will do all sort of thing. And sometimes being partners with those so treated, so you will be treated, you know, badly. When you come of age and know that the rabbis are hypocrites, then being enlightened, you suffered at the hands of the rabbis for criticizing them as the man who was locked in the graveyard to silence him, you know, that nobody listened to his criticism. He did, you know. To him, Jesus told him, by drowning 2,000 pigs, look, don't worry. If they do bad things, these things, they will die like pigs. And that's how they died during the destruction of temple, worse than pigs. For you had compassion on those in prison. So we have compassion because they are wrongly imprisoned, you know. Unrighteous people have imprisoned them, who were victims of false witnesses, are imprisoned for exposing the hypocrite temple priest, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property. When you don't agree with them, they will plunder your property. He's as the Mohammedan call him, a kafir, you know. So they plunder your property. Since you knew that you yourself had a better possession of gospel treasures and an abiding one that no one can steal from you. Where those treasures are in your heart, if they don't rust, nobody can steal. So they can steal your property. That nothing, you know, this one present in my heart, that they can't steal. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence. So keep in confidence. Don't say, you know, don't slip from the covenant. Stick to the covenant, which has a great reward, which is a resurrection, you know. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised, the resurrection. As Jesus, you know, laborers, when Jesus was giving the parable of marriage and divorce, Matthew 19, Peter said, we have left our house, home, you know, all that for your sake, what we will get. That is what they got, resurrection, you know, as their wage or their reward. So Jesus gave them confidence, you know, don't worry. For yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay, but my righteous one shall live by faith. That means the righteous, you know, people, they live by faith. We have faith in that when we are righteous, God will award us, you know. We don't wither away from that faith. We don't test our Father. We do our job, we leave it up to Him, you know, to His pleasure. We don't ask, beg for Him, we have done the job, give us the money now, as the Mammon priest do, you know, at the end of the month, they say, well, hey, my salary. But my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, that means he goes back into the other people, or slips, my soul has no pleasure in him. Then Christ, Paul said, you know, I worked so hard to convince you about this resurrection and all that, you know, and if you still slip back, you know, you are not sealed to serve God, you are in the doubting stage still, you know, then I don't have pleasure, you know, because I fished you into the royal kingdom of God and you have come out of it. That is, those who are twice born and convinced of resurrection in righteousness, that we have fished into the royal kingdom of God. If they slip back into the fashion of the world in which people cheat and fleece, then our efforts are wasted. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preservance, preserve their souls. You know, our soul, we have to preserve it, you know, by faith. We are sealed to serve God, and no one can deter us from our faith, from our path of righteousness. Those who shrink back for the sake of the comforts of flesh not only miss the chance of resurrection, but they suffer along with the crooks too, as at the trial of Jesus when the temple of Jerusalem was destroyed forever. Then those crook priests also suffered, you know. You remember the parable of wine press, and that is how Jesus sacked them, you know, destroying the wine press temple. Such people destroyed both their flesh and their soul. Thus, there is life in Christ Jesus and death in Mammon. Our Father God bless you. It is a very beautiful exposition.